is Guillaume Mazière. I'm running Temis in North America. What I'd like to thank the previous speakers, because really you definitely set the scene for my part, which is how content enrichment drives discovery. I have to say that I totally changed my mind with regard to the agenda, and this was yesterday evening. I really wanted to do some definition of the semantic content enrichment and then walk you through some use cases. And while I was doing this, I mean, I said to myself, okay, I'm going to insert the use cases in the definition. So for each definition, for each idea of content enrichment, I will try to give you an example that will actually illustrate the point I'm trying to explain. And then in the second part, I will briefly talk to you about implementing semantic content enrichment, how it could work in your organization. So this is a lot of things to do in 15 minutes. I'll try to go fast. Okay, so I really want to start from the beginning. If you think in terms of extracting knowledge from the content, you need to be able to understand the language itself, right? You need to be able to understand the sentence, the vocabulary, the syntax, and to be able to extract the key terms. So in this example, we have a pronoun, a verb, an article, a numerical value, etc. That's the first step. Then in the second step, I mean, the tool looks at the different terms, it groups them together, and it derives meaning from this. So that's why it starts to be a little bit semantic. That's why you start to have entities. In this case, you have a subject, you have a verb, and then you have entities like a patient, a symptom, a drug, and a dosage. But then, of course, you can draw meaning and derive facts from the extraction of entities. So in this case, really, you need to understand that this drug actually causes the side effect. So the symptom is caused by the drug. It's an adverse event. You can understand as well that the numerical value before the man is the age. The numerical value after the term concentration is likely to be a dosage. So here we take into account the context of the sentence, we take into account the whole grammatical structure of the contents of the sentence, sorry, to derive meaning. So that's why it gets really semantic. This is more than term matching or using a taxonomy and applying a taxonomy. It's a mix of using semantic rules to extract things that we don't know about based on the context of this specific sentence. So I did a few shortcuts here in terms of technology, but I mean the whole idea of term extraction, entity extraction, and then deriving from the sentence structure, the relationship is true in a sense. So that's where really you go from an unstructured sentence to something that is structured, in this case, a side effect with a specific dosage, a specific cause, and a specific patient. So if you look at it now from a document level or even a corpus level, for each document, and of course I took a medical example here, you would extract all the symptoms, all the disease, all the drug, etc. So when we speak about adding metadata, that's where it happens, really. The knowledge extraction, in a sense, is a document annotation and a content enrichment process. So the richer metadata is generated at this stage. Could be entities, could be topics, could be terms, it could be coming from an ontology or a taxonomy, or it could be coming from the semantic rules. So first example, and this is where I changed my mind yesterday. First example, how do we use the metadata in a customer-facing interface? So I took one example, which I like. It's fairly new. It's SA International, Society of Automotive and Aerospace Engineers. Maybe you heard of them in Pittsburgh. They just came out with a new digital library. It's mostly engineering document and the document related to the automotive and to the aerospace business. And they have a taxonomy. So this is a case where they have a taxonomy that we incorporated into an annotator, into a skill cartridge, and then we enriched the content with each leaf of the taxonomy. So when you do a search, you're provided with some topics which are coming from the taxonomy, so it's very controlled. It speaks to the engineer who look at that. I mean, something that they do understand. So the benefits, of course, to the publisher is the fact that it's a productivity gain in terms of tagging the content, right? The editorial productivity is real because they don't have to do this manually. For the current content, I mean, they could keep up with the new current content, doing it manually. But when they want to annotate the back files, here it's becoming extremely complex and lengthy to do this manually. There's another thing that it told us as well. I mean, they want to be able to change their mind, right, which is understandable. So if they modify the way, for example, I mean, all these things around the environment, the green fuel, et cetera, those are fairly new topics. So, of course, if they add those new topics to the taxonomy, then they can't go back to the legacy content and re-annotate, re-enrich everything. So that's where the automation brings some benefit as well. And what is the added value for the users? Well, of course, better navigation. You can drill down, and if you do a fairly vague search, like in this case, a diesel engine, you're being guided towards what you are supposedly looking for, the whole idea of faceted search or semantic search. So that's one example. It's simple, but it's a start. So let's move on to a higher level of complexity, and this relates to what Jason Wild from Nature presented. Once you have the entities, right, you can use them as a query to pull some external knowledge. This knowledge can be a prior knowledge. It could be your own knowledge, so the knowledge that resides within the publisher's knowledge assets. It could be some third-party knowledge. In this example, I linked the drug to drug bank. Jason mentioned that the genes were linked to entry genes, protein to Swiss prot. I mean, this is typical. If you're in the news business, I mean, you can link any person name to LinkedIn or things like that. So here, it's using the enrichment, the result of the annotation, to pull some external knowledge, I mean, external or internal, but to pull some supplemental knowledge to guide the user. So one example, which is the same as Jason, but Jason showed us the curation interface and then one article. I think this might be a different article that Jason gave me. So in this case, if you click here on the highlighting tool, you will have all the genes and protein automatically highlighted. If you mouse over MET25, you can look for it in UniProt or AntresGene. There is this feature that I really like on the portal. It's the inside the article. If you think of the biologist looking at this, I mean, what is he looking for? Most probably he's looking for a protein or for a gene, right? So here, if you click here, you have a list of protein, and it's a very curated list. It's really accurate, and then you have the list of the gene as well. So it's a reading help in this case, together with supplemental knowledge if you mouse over a specific entity. So it's a very powerful example. And I think it's an interesting mix of an hybrid approach where part of the process is automated, and then part of it is curated by this new team at Nature. Okay, let's move on. So we saw the raw document, the annotation, we just saw the knowledge insertion, and the next step, of course, is the linking. If we keep the example that I just gave, I mean, you can link, for example, on the same authors. This is very easy. It's linking on the metadata, and I'm sure you all have this capability. You can link on the same drug, more articles related to this drug, or you can link something a little bit more complex, more articles on different drugs, but mentioning the same side effect. Once you have the rich metadata, that's a semantic query, in a sense, and that's fairly easy to implement. So I took a third example of content leaking, and I decided that I would take an example maybe outside of scholarly publishing, and I chose something which I like at McGraw-Hill. You know Aviation Week, of course. It's a weekly magazine that potentially all the engineers in the aerospace aerospace world are reading. This is the visible tip of the iceberg, of course. It's a major website. And within the Aviation Week website, there is the Aviation Week Intelligence Network, which is the subscription-based website. And that's really a good product for this specific audience. So in this example, if you click on any article, you have all the entities highlighted. So we decided to work with them on two specific entities, the aircraft, what they call the program, and the aircraft or the airplane manufacturers or the space manufacturers. So Boeing Commercial Airplanes, Airbus, etc. are highlighted. Based on those entities, you're being suggested with related article. So in this case, you have more article about the same topic, which is the increase in production rate for specific planes coming from Boeing. So you see that the related article are all mentioning the same type of plane and the same type of topic. And then you have feature market analysis as well. And then you have latest chart and graph. So you use all those entities to suggest more content, more knowledge to the reader. And then you can link some unstructured knowledge, like this article, to structured knowledge. So for each aircraft manufacturer, the editorial team at Aviation Week, they maintain a database of knowledge about those companies. So in this example, if you mouse over Boeing commercial airplane, you will see an example of a table where you have more information about the company, shareholders, the key executives, the key program that they're working with, suppliers, etc. And then you have a list of related articles. The same occurs for a program, the A320. You have an explanation of the program itself, which is really an editorial piece. It's a summary. And then you have the name of the potential suppliers for this program, the A320, and then you have recent articles. So I like this example because you keep moving from articles to structured data and then back to articles once you're in the structured data. When we speak to the editor-in-chief and to the people at Aviation Week, I mean, the way they see that is it's a queryless navigation. And I like the idea. You do one query, and then the idea is to keep you on the site as much as they can. So it's good for customer retention. It's good for the user experience. But they don't want the user to do a search, read a document, and then move on, or do another search and then read another document. The whole idea is to keep suggesting pertinent content to the reader. So it's really a navigation thing more than search and retrieve. And I think it's pretty efficient. They did some testing on the time spent by their users, and they are a professional audience, so they don't have a lot of time to spend, and the increase was pretty dramatic. So back to my chart, and I keep moving on in terms of use cases and possibilities. So we saw all this. We saw the linking, and this was the McGraw-Hill example. The next step is, I don't know if it's more complex or more sophisticated, it's really providing similar documents. You don't really match on a specific entity. You just match on the semantic fingerprint and the meaning of the article itself. So here I took an example from Springer, the latest version of Springer Link. In this example, I mean, you have the knowledge spillover and economic growth, and you can view related documents. So I did a zoom on this pop-up window here. So you have a document, related document widget that links the reader to additional content. It's based on the current document. It's not based on the entity. It's not given that those documents share the same companies or people that are mentioned. It's only based on the content itself. And that's interesting as well. You know, of course, that at Springer, they have a very wide variety of content. So the taxonomic approach can't apply, right? They can't have a taxonomy for all the content that they have. So they thought that giving a semantic fingerprint for each article and then proposing, rather than a faceted search typically powered by the taxonomy, rather than that, proposing similar documents would be a good user experience. And same as McGraw-Hill, the goal in the end is to provide relevant data to the reader and to keep the readers longer on the website and to make sure that they consume more data, so the cost at the time of renewal is going to be more interesting. There is one specificity for Springer which I found interesting. It's this slicing and dicing approach of the books. They can match book, chapter, and article. So when we enrich their content, we enrich the books divided into chapters, so we could compare the semantic fingerprint of an article and a book. So if you're reading an article, you could be provided with a book chapter. And of course, they sell the book chapter by the unit as well. Some stats that they were kind enough to share with us. 19% of the visitor actually used the similar document tool, which I found pretty high. And they have noticed year over year a 9% increase in page views since the tool, I mean the semantic document widget has been deployed, which is a good thing for them. Time-wise, I'm a few minutes left. Okay. So I'm thinking I'm going to give you maybe a quick overview on this in 5 minutes, and then just a conclusion. So how does it work? I mean, what's under the hood, really? So in 5 minutes, it's a little bit ambitious. But here's how we structured the Luxeed platform that Hélène at Elsevier and Jason at Nature mentioned briefly earlier. So first, there is what we call the annotation factory. This is the grinder. This is where the XML gets in and the enriched XML gets out, right? It's fairly easy to see it like this. What's interesting, what's happening within the annotation factory, it's a mix of different things. You have some of it is statistical. If you do categorization, you learn from a data set of document and then you apply the categorization. Some of it is machine learning. In some cases, you will ask a human to tag a few things and then the machine will learn from this. This applies to certain cases. And then some of it, I would say most of it, is based on semantic rules that we can write or that the publisher can write or that we have off the shelf for specific domains like biology, chemistry, medical, etc. And it's also based on third-party ontology. If you have medical content and you want the medical content to be annotated with mesh, that's fine. The mesh can be fairly easily turned into a scale cartridge. So third-party or internal. We have many customers who already have their own taxonomy. They want to use this to enrich their content. That's fine as well. It's not that simple. I mean, you don't really take a taxonomy and then turn it into a scale cartridge. You need to add some logic to it. Many part of the taxonomy can be ambiguous, so you need to remove the ambiguity with some semantic rules, and you need to make sure that you don't overgenerate tags when you tag with a taxonomy. So it's a bit more complex than that, but that's the idea. You have different options. It's not a one-size-fits-all type of technique, right? In some cases, machine learning is great. In some other cases, you want to extract something which are very specific. It's a good use case for semantic rules. It's not only about the tagging. I mean, I heard a lot during this conference, tagging, tagging, tagging. It's also inserting the links, right? Inserting external knowledge, and then in the end, enabling analytics. We heard as well a lot during the conference, extracting entities. I mean, entities are one thing, drugs, protein, disease, it's very useful. But in the example that I gave earlier, I mean, there was a semantic relationship, which was really the real meaning of the sentence. I mean, this side effect was the whole thing, and this was very essential to extract it. The scale cartridge library is the name of the annotator that are developed by Temis and off the shelf. We decided to separate, and I think that's key, the scale cartridges from the engine itself. So in some cases, for different type of data, you want to annotate this specific data, for example, with people, company, and location. You're going to use one scale cartridge and a specific data source. If you analyze news, you could analyze them with sentiment analysis. If you don't have a specific taxonomy, you can use a topic extraction. And then if you have a very specific content, biological, medical, or chemical, in this case, you can leverage those taxonomies or those scale cartridges as well. So here again, it's not one size fits all. It could be a sequence, it could be an escalation of scale cartridges to power the right tagging and linking strategy. And then finally, if you enter into a semantic enrichment project, you want to avoid the black box effect, okay? You need to be able to see why this has been extracted, for which reason. So you need to be able to open the hood and check what's happening. So the way we look at it is we deliver a content enrichment studio where you have different interfaces. You don't need to be a computational linguist to use it. And you can insert, modify terminology, you can modify hierarchy, you can train a scale cartridge on a specific data set. Of course, you can measure and track the quality, because typically you do this before you go to the deployment. And once you're happy with the quality, you can deploy the scale cartridge in the library, which itself is connected to the annotation factory. And then you go back to this interface in times to times to do corrections, to add things, and again, you can change your mind. Okay, so I think time for the conclusion. One slide, really, and this is, I don't think this is my conclusion. I mean, I think this adapts fairly well to the four speakers, really. So the benefits for this is really for the user. I mean, you can make highly relevant content more findable. I also use a findability JSON, so no issue here. You can improve the precision and recall of the search engine because you have a richer index. Altogether, you boost the quality of the search results, so that's one thing. Then number two, you can use the metadata to power facets, so it's a facilitation of the exploration, of the navigation, from searching to navigating. When you start adding some external knowledge or delivering your own knowledge to the readers, to the users, then you boost their insight. You provide them with links with similar documents. And then finally, it's a more proactive delivery. It's a more proactive relationship between you, the publisher, and the user. So you make the explicit asking sometimes unnecessary. And you think of it in terms of navigation and delivering the right content rather than just a search experience. That's what I had. Thank you.